Back here at the line table, it's time to talk a little more about the MCOR shooting. Robert Reza was the man who shot and killed two people earlier this month before turning that gun in himself. Police say he might have been suffering from mental health issues, and that could explain at least part of the reason he went on the shooting spree in the first place. In light of that revelation, Albuquerque Mayor Berry is reportedly reconsidering a controversial mental health bill known as Kendra's Law. The measure would make it mandatory for some people suffering from mental illness to undergo treatment. As you recall, then-Mayor Martin Chavez introduced the law back in 2005 after John Hyde went on a similar murder spree. But the courts later struck it down. Sophie, let me start with you. Kendra's Law only applied to people that have been identified to be a threat to themselves or others. And there's going to be some question, of course, about Mr. Reza. We will never know since, you know, obviously a tragedy happened there, too. But in light of that, is revisiting Kendra's Law just going to end up in the same place in court where, with that same result?
Well, it certainly could, because we do have this issue where the state has law on the books that is different from that that has been proposed for the city. Whether the city will say we're going to do a variation on Kendra's Law in order to get around that, but the state allows the state law says basically that you have to have agreement or buy-in from the person in question, whereas the city's law would allow the city, the courts, to say you don't have a choice in this. You will be placed on medication, you will be placed in long-term care. There's some real concern, not just about the coercion that we see, that there's the potential for coercion there, but also the possibility that we will know less about people who are in distress because they will withhold information knowing that they could be involuntarily committed, they could be involuntarily medicated. And we have a terrible history in this country in terms of how we treat people with mental illness. And there's very grave concern that we could be heading down one of those paths again.
Sure, it is a path, Jim. I mean, but is that an answer? I mean, let me back up. Would that solve the problem? That's the bottom line question. Would that prevent things from happening?
Theoretically, yes, it would. Okay. If everything worked, you know, the way the law says, you know, if you had the counselors who would notify people or the relatives or friends and the system worked and you had the caseworkers and you could get into court quickly and somebody could follow it through. We don't have the money, though, to enforce Kendra's
Law. I heard
law.
Seven things.
The resources. Right. I talked to a number of social workers who deal with mentally ill people on the street where you do have serious crime. We've had instances of rapes and murders by people who don't take their medication at health care for the homeless. They pass it out. They don't want it because they like being crazy. They like the highs, whatever it is. There's no caseworkers to follow through on this, and that is the big problem. Against that, you have to weigh the fact that if we could make it work, those five individuals that Hyde killed would be alive, and look at that tragedy and place the value on their lives, or if Mr. Reza at the MCOR shooting had fallen into this category, those lives would have been saved, and those people would be alive, versus the what I think is relatively minimal intrusion into civil rights, which is you have to take your medicine so you're not a danger to people. It's not like you can't, you know, say anything.
Sure.
It doesn't restrict other liberty.
Sure.
But the challenge is there's a lot of money that would be required to make this work, and I don't know that we have it. Maybe we need to find it.
Sure. What do you think, TJ?
I did a little research on this before I got here, and it seems the only people that are against this are there are some anti-psychiatric groups that say that are just against any kind of psychiatric treatment at all, which I find kind of odd.
Patient advocacy groups as well, though.
And also the, just drew a blank.
That's okay.
But my problem I see with it is the enforceability of it, what you were just talking about. I mean, I think it's, the law's great. We need to do something here. It's can you get these people in to get their treatments? Mm-hmm. You know, that's the big problem.
Sure. Laura, in Jim's list of seven or eight
Civil Liberties Union.
Civil Liberties, sure.
I'm sorry.
Absolutely.
Comes to me like
somehow
just,
I knew that's who you were thinking.
Yeah. What I think about the Civil Liberties Union. But anyway,
easy. Okay. Now, Jim rattled off seven or eight steps along the way there. It seems to me any one of those that you rattled off, the whole thing just unravels.
Right.
So not just money and not just caseworkers, we're talking about a really complicated puzzle here.
It is a very complicated puzzle, and I think, you know, I'm torn on this issue. I can see a lot of different sides on it, but I think trying to make policy stick based on an incident like this. I mean, I think it's a tragedy, it's terrible, it's gripped the community, certainly. It's caused us to question a lot of policies, a lot of what we know about folks who have problems like this. But I think there needs to be a lot more research and data collected about how it would be applied and mm-hmm. and who would be making those decisions. It gives right. me some comfort on the one hand that it would be a judge making this decision, so there would be some need for procedural protections. So there would be, but on the other hand, given the gaps in our legal system and the lack of adequate representation, often based on means, mm-hmm. that could be a real problem. So
well, let me ask you a question. You're around, courtroom proceedings a lot. What happens if somebody goes to jail for a significant amount of time? It could be, it's significant, it could be 3 months, 90 days, a year, 2 years, and they don't get their medication in jail even. You see what I'm saying? There's right. a lot of gaps, it seems to me.
There are a lot of gaps, and yeah. I think that's part of the problem. It's such an incredibly complicated issue, and I don't know that necessarily, I don't think the evidence is in yet about whether the Reza situation, the MCOR situation, was directly a result of just the meds. I think there's still some question about mm-hmm. the domestic situation. Yeah. There's all kinds of issues. It's a very complicated situation, but I think you're right. That particular law was struck down at the local level. Mm-hmm. This would be an approach to try to enact it at the state level, which could change things a little mm-hmm. bit in terms of the overall authority. It might be able to stick in that sense, but I think there's a lot of problems with forcing somebody to take medication against their will, and who's to say that somebody is actually a danger? Mm. Like, at what level are they actually being assessed as dangerous to themselves or others versus somebody who's just problematic from time to time? Or, I think there's just a lot of problems with it, and hopefully people won't react to this situation in terms of, get caught up in the terrible circumstances and the emotion of that situation mm-hmm. in really thinking through how this law would work, if
sure.
that's the case.
Sure, and so for the other part of this, too, is all medications do not necessarily solve all problems. You talk to people in the business of mental health, there's always that sort of an experimental stage
absolutely.
To figure out what the best
certainly.
Mix is.
Yeah. yeah. And so I think that this goes back to what Jim was saying, what I was saying earlier. We are not set up as a state to deal under normal circumstances with people who are willing to receive mm. treatment. And we hear stories about individuals who have sought treatment for themselves, have sought medication for themselves, and for various reasons have not been able to receive it. And so we're passing up potentially an opportunity to deal with this in a proactive way, and instead coming down on people after the fact is perhaps not the best way to put it.
Sure.
But we have cut funding, ignored opportunities, blown past gaps in our system, and now we get to a point where we see a crisis because of this situation, and we want to bring the hammer down.
Yeah.
And it's like we have all these other things we can do as well, and
yeah.
and they're just not in place.
It's a tough issue, isn't it? It's a tough issue. I got to hold you off with that one, my brother. Sorry about that. Now, there's been a lot of debate and discussion this week about a couple of cases. You've heard about this, children being left unattended in hot cars. Two people have been charged with a felony abuse, child abuse, after leaving their three kids locked in a hot camper at Elephant Butte Lake while they went water skiing or jet skiing or whatever it was. The kids were eventually rescued by park rangers, and thank God. And another mother has been charged here in Albuquerque in the death of her two-year-old daughter, who died a week and a half ago after being left in a hot car at the Southwestern Indian Polytechnic Institute. Excuse me. Stephanie Pignon, she faces a count of child abuse resulting in death, and that's a first-degree felony, Jim, and you've tried these cases, you've been around these cases a lot. These are amazing tragedies, but in your experience, is there a way to get to an appropriate level of punishment here when these situations happen?
Well, the first step is adjudication, and mm-hmm. there's a lot of debate about whether a parent who leaves a child in a car should even be charged, because mm-hmm. people say, well, it's just an accident. And I don't think that argument gets very far, because so many other things that we prosecute are accidents. We prosecute animal abuse, mm-hmm. where somebody forgets the puppy that's tethered in the backyard and roasts in the sun and dies. Mm-hmm. Or a caregiver, at a daycare center that forgets a child, or somebody even on a road who does something negligent. They forget something and they kill someone else. So simply saying an accident doesn't get you there, because what you're dealing with is the loss of an innocent human life, the destruction of innocent human life by an act of negligence. I don't know many cases where parents actually who do this inadvertently. And there's a whole range of other things, you can find cases where they use that as daycare. They just lock the kid in the car. I mean, that is intentional, and that rises to another level. But just in dealing with the destruction of the life of the child by the negligence of the parent, rarely do they result in jail sentences. It frequently results in some supervision regarding safety for the other children, and so frequently, you know, there have been other cases like that. It's a hard, hard, hard situation. There's no fast and clear rule. It's a tough call for prosecutors, but behind it all, you have to realize that what has occurred is that a child has been killed, and society has to address that somehow and cannot just shrug it off and say it's an accident.
Sure. TJ, what do you think? What's the next move for society to come to grips with?
What's more heinous than this, really, when you think about it? I mean, there's some pretty terrible crimes out there, murder, rape, and this has to be, you know, in the top four of all these types of crimes. And, you know, we took a lot of calls on this on the air. And sterilization was brought up. Mm. I mean, seriously brought up. I mean, it'll never happen, but I mean, I think that these are things we need to look at. How many times do we have to tell people not to do this? What is it going to take to break through the gross ignorance to get down to this?
Let me ask you a question. Do you make a distinction between the young woman who forgot she had a child in the van and the couple who knew their kids were in that camper and went out for fun and games out on the water? Same thing to you?
Obviously, I was not there, so I cannot speak to the woman who left who killed her child. Yeah. She's responsible for killing her child. I don't know what you can say with that. You can obviously see what happened in Elephant Butte. I mean, that was, to me, that seems as willful as it could possibly be. We're leaving the kids in, we're going out to have a good time. Mm-hmm. It makes me physically ill.
Sure. It's a first degree felony. It's a heavy charge. Sure. I mean, is it tough to prosecute with that charge?
Well, I mean, I think it's going to be, you know, this is an interesting situation. It's difficult because in the court of public opinion, obviously, maximum sentence, throw the book at her.
Sure.
Very, very difficult, heinous situation. I mean, it's gut-wrenching and terrible any way you cut it. But I do think that, you know, I do make a distinction between those two situations, with the woman leaving the child in the car versus the couple who left them in the camper to go out and run errands and then go, you know, go on the jet ski or whatever it was. I think those are two different situations because we're talking about what the intent was behind the actions. On the one hand, they knew they were leaving their children and they were going off to run errands and do whatever they were doing. So there was intent there to leave their child. On the other one, you know, we've heard these horrible, every summer we hear of these all over the place, and it's terrible that this happened here. But parents who are busy and do all kinds of other things and forget that one day that they're supposed to take care of the kid, you know, take them to the daycare or whatever, leave them in the back seat and go about their business all day long. I mean, there was another story that we read along those lines where the father just forgot that the child was in the back seat, went to work, and 9 hours later realized that the child had been in the vehicle. I mean, I think that there's some absent-mindedness that goes along with that. That doesn't excuse it or give it, you know, there still will probably need to be some criminal liability, but I do make a distinction between that and somebody intentionally leaving their child to go run a bunch of errands. I mean, in that situation, it just seems like there was there was almost a pattern. I'd want to, you know, expand the facts a little bit more. What happened before? Has there been a history of this? Right. We don't know anything about it. Well, I don't know anything about that situation. So I'd hope that in a court and the prosecution of it and making decisions on criminal liability, that those types of facts would be taken into consideration as well.
Mm-hmm. I think one of the things that we really need to keep in mind about this, people, we go around the table, I would never do that. I would never do that. That's a horrible and a heinous thing. Last year, major Pulitzer Prize winning piece of investigative journalism in the Washington Post, in which the journalist went and spoke with experts on this issue. I mean, there are people who study what happens on the day that this happens, what happens in people's brains, what's going on in the car, et cetera, and advocacy groups that champion kid safety in these circumstances. And what we hear over and over again is that in the vast majority of cases, these are not irresponsible parents. These are very responsible parents who have unusual is not even the right word, an extraordinary circumstance on a particular day. It kills them. It devastates them. They are punished more than if they were locked away. And unfortunately, a number of years ago, Congress had an opportunity to require auto manufacturers to include an alarm in cars that would warn parents, listen, your kid is still in this car, because things do happen. You know, the great quote in this article, if you've ever forgotten your cell phone, you could forget your child. That's just the way our brains are wired, as heinous as that is. We had an opportunity, there was a moment where regulation was proposed that would force auto manufacturers to include an alarm in the car. If that child seat has a kid in it, an alarm goes off when you get out of the car, and the auto industry killed it because they said it was too expensive. And so we look at the devastation on these families, we look at the death of these children, and here's the reality. It happens to responsible parents. And I think that we do a disservice to ourselves and to our children if we say it couldn't happen to me, because if you're not paying attention, it could. Mm-hmm. So please be vigilant and take the warning from this situation.
We're going to leave it there. Happen. Very well said. Now, let us know what you'd like the line panelists to talk about in an upcoming show. You can email us at infocus@kanemia.org or drop us a line on our website.